Levels of mental retardation. Mental retardation is a condition, not a disease, and refers to an individual's level of intellectual functioning. Those who are mildly retarded are capable of learning numerous skills and living independent or semi-independent adult lives. The mentally retarded generally learn more slowly than non-retarded people and may exhibit social immaturity. Approximately 90% of those diagnosed as retarded are in fact mildly retarded. Individuals who are moderately retarded are generally able to learn to care for themselves with special training and in adulthood can often work with supervision. Individuals who exhibit severe and profound retardation will most noticeably experience delays in speech and coordination skills. They frequently have physical handicaps in addition to mental retardation, and some need constant care, while others can learn to perform routine tasks on their own. Mental retardation is a term used to describe a person with certain limitations in mental functioning and social skills with specific regard to communicating and taking care of himself or herself. Children diagnosed with mental retardation tend to experience slower development than a typical child and may take longer learning to speak, walk, and attend to their personal needs such as dressing and eating. They are likely to have difficulty learning in school because they learn at a much lower speed, and there may be some things they are unable to learn at all. Mild mental retardation. Mild mental retardation is a diagnosis given to children and adults whose scores on a standardized intelligence test fall between 80 and 100. In many ways, the children and adults with mild mental retardation seem very normal and reasonably intelligent. However, in certain areas of academics or life skills, these people or children fall short and have difficulty catching up to their peers. Mild mental retardation, MMR, has many causes: anoxia at birth, child abuse, genetics, drug and alcohol abuse by the mother while the child is still in utero. All of these are causes of MMR. Diagnoses in which MMR is secondary to the primary diagnostic axis are fragile X, Down syndrome, and a few other more common diagnoses. There have even been cases where a mother had cancer and started receiving chemotherapy before they discovered she was pregnant. The mental retardation occurred because the mother's chemo affected the baby's brain development in the early stages. It is typically diagnosed when a child is a little older than preschool age, unless there is an obvious disorder at birth like Down's. A child must be able to talk in order to perform intelligence tests, and some intelligence tests have to wait until school age. Parents can generally tell if there is something amiss with their child's ability to learn between age 3 and age 6, when most of these children are referred for an evaluation. MMR can be the primary diagnosis, but only if there are no primary causes of it present. In approximately 80% of all the MMR cases, a primary diagnosis precedes MMR on the four diagnostic axis. While it is not unheard of, MMR in autistic children and adults is rare because of the way autism wires the brain. The idiot savants of 60 or more years ago were considered to have MMR because they couldn't answer standard everyday questions. But this notion has been proven invalid, and thus idiot savant is no longer used to describe people and children with autism. In more cases where autism is the co-diagnosis with another syndrome and is supposed to have MMR as part of its own diagnosis, as in Down's, the autism actually prevents the MMR from coming through. This suggests that the two diagnoses have some genetic connection, but autism somehow has a stronger bearing on the development of the child than the Downs they were born with. The problem is, so very few of these children are born, it makes it extremely difficult to study just what it is about autism that alters the intellectual capacity of the Downs children. Mild mental retardation does not have a cure. It usually does not have a negative impact on the quality of life of the individuals who have it, and many can lead quite normal lives. Most might require extra assistance as adults, since little things like balancing a checkbook or formulating a monthly budget don't make much sense to them. They tend to be easily persuaded to do things even when those things seem wrong to them and need guidance in decision making. Other than that, children and adults with no other diagnosis can live and lead very full lives. Some have even been married and raised children of their own. Their intelligence levels do not affect their physical abilities, and many children and adults with MMR live to very ripe old age. Individuals with mild intellectual disabilities, formerly referred to as educable, are likely to need only intermittent to limited support. Typically, do not look different from their non-disabled peers, often have only mild or moderate developmental delays except in academics, which is often the major area of deficit. Therefore, they are not often identified until they enter the school setting where their cognitive disability is more apparent. Students with mild MR spend most of the school day in the regular classroom. They typically attain 3rd to 6th grade academic achievement levels by the time they finish high school. As adults, many, though not all, with mild MR will be able to obtain independent employment. Many will marry, have children, and blend rather indistinguishably into the community. For those who achieve total independence, the label of mental retardation is no longer appropriate. Moderate mental retardation. Individuals in this category are slow in developing comprehension and use of language, and their eventual achievement in this area is limited. Achievement of self-care and motor skills is also retarded, and some need supervision throughout life. Progress in schoolwork is limited, but a proportion of these individuals learn the basic skills needed for reading, writing, and counting. Educational programs can provide opportunities for them to develop their limited potential and to acquire some basic skills. Such programs are appropriate for slow learners with a low ceiling of achievement. As adults, moderately retarded people are usually able to do simple practical work if the tasks are carefully structured and skilled supervision is provided. Completely independent living in adult life is rarely achieved. Generally, however, such people are fully mobile and physically active, and the majority show evidence of social development in their ability to establish contact, to communicate with others, and to engage in simple social activities. The IQ is usually in the range 35 to 49. Discrepant profiles of abilities are common in this group, with some individuals achieving higher levels in visuospatial skills than in tasks dependent on language, while others are markedly clumsy but enjoy social interaction and simple conversation. The level of development of language is variable. Some of those affected can take part in simple conversations, while others have only enough language to communicate their basic needs. Some never learn language, though they may understand simple instructions and may learn to use manual signs to compensate for their speech disabilities to some extent. An organic etiology can be identified in a majority of moderately mentally retarded people. Childhood autism or other pervasive developmental disorders are present in a substantial minority and have a major effect upon the clinical picture and the type of management needed. Epilepsy and neurological and physical disabilities are also common, although most moderately retarded people are able to walk without assistance. It is sometimes possible to identify other psychiatric conditions, but the limited level of language development may make diagnosis difficult and dependent upon information obtained from others who are familiar with the individual. Individuals with moderate to severe intellectual disabilities, formally called trainable, will probably need limited to extensive support. They are more likely to have a recognizable syndrome such as Down syndrome, therefore may look different than their non-disabled peers. Their development is often significantly delayed. They are typically identified as infants or toddlers. Most begin receiving special education during the preschool years. They may be included in the regular classroom part of the school day, but often spend much of the school day in a separate classroom where they learn adaptive living skills. As adults, most individuals with moderate to severe MR will not achieve total independence. Rather, they are likely to continue to need limited to extensive support such as that provided in group homes or semi-independent living situations, SILs. Some may continue to live with their parents. Some individuals with moderate to severe MR may be able to succeed in modified competitive employment situations. However, many will work in supported, non-competitive settings such as sheltered workshops. Severe mental retardation. Most people in this category suffer from a marked degree of motor impairment or other associated deficits, indicating the presence of clinically significant damage to or maldevelopment of the central nervous system. The symptoms of severe mental retardation are often mental and behavioral rather than physical, although in some cases, mental symptoms are linked to more complicated syndromes that present other related symptoms as well. Language skills and social skills typically develop very slowly and may not develop at all in a person with very severe mental retardation. A lack of curiosity is quite common among children with severe mental retardation, and this lack of engagement and interest may be an early indicator of the condition. Impaired cognitive functioning, often measured as an IQ below 70, is a common indicator of retardation. Children with severe retardation typically have a significantly lower IQ. The IQ is usually in the range 20 to 34. People with mild or moderate mental retardation can often develop the skills needed to live independently so long as they are given additional assistance and training. Men and women with severe mental retardation are less likely to be able to master basic life skills. A person with a very severe form of this condition might continue to interact with the world as would an infant and might require supportive care throughout his or her life. This condition has a wide variety of different causes, and in many cases, no cause can be identified. Some genetic problems can cause this condition, and many of these can be screened for. Other genetic problems occur during the actual process of conception and development and can be detected only after a child has been conceived. In other cases, Severe mental retardation may be caused by environmental factors. A number of infections can damage a fetus or a small child and lead to this condition. Certain toxic substances, most notably lead, can cause retardation, particularly when encountered by very young children or fetuses. Physical injury can damage the brain, and certain types of physical brain damage may manifest as severe mental retardation. The treatment and prognosis for this condition vary on a case-by-case basis. Additional training in life skills can enable some people with this condition to live relatively independent lives. In other cases, learning and progress are more limited. Each case and each prognosis depends on many different factors. Profound mental retardation. Profound mental retardation is the most serious and rare form of retardation. Only about 1 to 2% of mentally retarded individuals are classified as having profound mental retardation, which means the patient has an IQ score below 20 to 25. People who are profoundly retarded often cannot manage basic daily tasks on their own and may never learn to communicate effectively. These individuals usually live in highly supervised settings to help them with their daily needs and ensure they remain safe. Patients who are diagnosed with profound retardation often have an underlying neurological disorder that is at least partially responsible for their mental conditions. Some conditions that cause mental retardation are inherited, such as Fragile X syndrome and Down syndrome. Other underlying causes include prenatal illnesses. Some illnesses and problems during pregnancy can predispose a child to mental retardation, such as fetal alcohol syndrome, or complications from a mother diagnosed with rubella, toxoplasmosis, high blood pressure, or glandular problems during her pregnancy. Comprehension and use of language is limited to, at best, understanding basic commands and making simple requests. The most basic and simple visuospatial skills of sorting and matching may be acquired, and the affected person may be able, with appropriate supervision and guidance, to take a small part in domestic and practical tasks. An organic etiology can be identified in most cases. Severe neurological or other physical disabilities affecting mobility are common, as are epilepsy and visual and hearing impairments. Pervasive developmental disorders in their most severe form, especially atypical autism, are particularly frequent, especially in those who are mobile. Children with profound mental retardation often begin showing signs at birth or shortly thereafter, though the level of retardation may not be properly diagnosed until the child is school age. Mentally retarded children often have trouble developing basic skills that come easier for other children, such as walking and talking. Profoundly retarded children are usually placed in special classrooms with teachers trained in helping mentally retarded children. Children who are profoundly mentally retarded can learn some basic skills, and their education often focuses on teaching them how to respond to situations that could endanger them. People diagnosed with profound mental retardation cannot work or care for themselves. They experience difficulties in movement and must use assisting devices such as wheelchairs or walkers to get around. These individuals can rarely communicate effectively through speech and may rely on basic sounds and gestures to communicate their needs and wants. Caregivers in group homes and other facilities often devise their own system of communicating with profoundly retarded patients. Most people with profound mental retardation do not handle changes in routine well, which is why it is often better for them to live in group homes where their daily lives are heavily scheduled and monitored. Some people with this level of retardation require assistance with almost every daily task, including showering and taking care of basic hygiene, eating and getting dressed. Family members who wish to keep profoundly retarded loved ones at home often require the help of a home nurse or other specialists. Classification of people with mental retardation in India. Based on the 1983 AAMR definition, the operational classification for persons with mental retardation is given in the table. As we can see from this table, persons having an IQ range of 52 to 67 in the Stanford-Binet and Cattell tests, as well as those having an IQ score between 55 and 69 in the Wechsler scales, are categorized as having mild mental retardation. India has approximately 89% of mentally retarded people with mild mental retardation. Patients having an IQ range of 36 to 51 in the Stanford-Binet and Cattell tests, as well as those having an IQ score between 4 and 54 in the Wechsler scales, are categorized as having moderate mental retardation. 7% of the mentally retarded people in India have moderate mental retardation. Severe mental retardation patients have an IQ range of 20 to 35 in the Stanford-Binet and Cattell tests, as well as those having an IQ score between 25 and 39 in the Wechsler scales, are categorized as having severe mental retardation. 3% of the mentally retarded people in India have severe mental retardation. Persons having an IQ range of 0 to 19 Stanford-Binet and Cattell tests, as well as those having IQ scores between 0 and 24 in the Wechsler scales, are categorized as having profound mental retardation. India has just 1% of mentally retarded people with profound mental retardation. Educational classification. In the special education centers in India, the classroom classification in operation is as shown. Most of the classification systems define mental retardation with emphasis on significantly sub-average intellectual functioning of the individual, assessed by the standardized intelligence tests. In India, where a majority live in rural areas, engaged mostly with traditional semi-skilled vocations, the adapted Indian intelligence tests have limitations in assessing the exact levels of intelligence due to lack of standardization on such population. No standard test has been so far developed suited to the Indian cultural milieu. Certification. A disability certificate is issued by a medical board duly constituted by the central and the state governments. The state government will constitute a medical board consisting of at least 3 members, out of which at least one may be a specialist in the concerned field. In need of correction in the certification process are limited availability of the specialists in respective areas of disability, distance from the residents to the assessment and certification location, lack of guidelines for the standard test and the person to be engaged for assessment. No indigenously established behavior norms are available. Therefore, in conclusion, we can say the following. About 75 to 80% of mental retardation is familial, that is, it runs in families, and 20 to 25% is due to organic problems, such as chromosomal abnormalities or brain damage. Mild to severe mental retardation is a symptom of several hundred single gene disorders and many chromosomal abnormalities, including small deletions. Based on twin studies, moderate to severe mental retardation do not appear to be familial, but mild mental retardation does. that is, the relatives of the moderate to severely mentally retarded have normal ranges of IQs, whereas the families of the mildly mentally retarded have IQs skewing lower. Mild mental retardation. IQ 50 to 55 to 70. Children require mild support, formally called educable mentally retarded. At this level, a person takes longer duration to learn to talk but can communicate well once he or she knows how fully independent he or she is in self-care, has problems with reading and writing, is socially immature, is unable to deal with responsibilities of marriage or parenting, may benefit from specialized education plans, has an IQ range of 50 to 69, may have associated conditions including autism, epilepsy, or physical disability. Moderate retardation, IQ 35 to 40 to 50 to 55. Children require moderate supervision and assistance, formally called trainable mentally retarded. At this level, a person is slow in understanding and using language, has only a limited ability to communicate, can learn basic reading, writing, counting skills, is a slow learner, is unable to live alone, can get around on own, can take part in simple social activities, has an IQ range of 35 to 49. Severe mental retardation, IQ 20 to 25 to 35 to 40, can be taught basic life skills and simple tasks with supervision. At this level, a person has noticeable motor impairment, has severe damage to and or abnormal development of central nervous system, has an IQ range of 20 to 34. Profound mental retardation, IQ below 20 to 25, usually caused by a neurological condition, require constant care. At this level, a person is unable to understand or comply with requests or instructions, is immobile, must wear diapers, uses very basic non-verbal communication, cannot care for own needs, requires constant help and supervision. When mental retardation stroke intellectual disability occurs with other serious physical problems, the life expectancy of the child may be shortened. In general, the more severe the cognitive disability and the more physical problems the child has, the shorter the life expectancy. However, a child with mild to moderate mental retardation stroke intellectual disability has a fairly normal life expectancy. As adults, these people can often be successful at jobs that require basic intellectual skills, can live independently, and can support themselves.